Jesus' baptism. Jesus was not brought to a church as a to be blessed and dedicate that child to God. You could read about that story in Luke's Gospel. But what happened is that some years later, this young man named John received a revelation from God that he was to initiate a new ritual which would call people to repentance, offer them a bath of forgiveness, and prepare them for the Messiah. So at some point in his early adult life, John, Jesus' cousin probably, made his way to the desert near the Jordan River and began calling upon people to repent and be baptized. They came to him from everywhere, and they were immersed in the water while they were confessing their sins. And about the same time, the Gospels tell us that the adult Jesus also came to the Jordan to be baptized. And when he came forward, John recognized him and said, "You should be baptizing me. This is the wrong way." But Jesus insisted that he experienced the same ritual as everybody else. So he submitted to being baptized. And suddenly you hear that after he was baptized, a great theophany occurred, divine event. The heavens were opened. The Holy Spirit descended upon Jesus in the form of a dove. And everybody heard the voice of God say, "This is my beloved Son, in whom I am well pleased." Now, if you read further on after this story, there's no after baptism party for Jesus. He didn't get together with his friends and we congratulated each other about being baptized. No. If we read on, we're told that the Holy Spirit that descended upon him then drove him into the desert where he fasted and prayed for 40 days and was tempted by the devil. And after that event, he came out of the desert and began gathering disciples, choosing his apostles. Now, if you think about that picture of Jesus' baptism and what we do when we're baptized, you think it's just two completely different events. And certainly there are differences between the two, obviously. But the fact is, what happened to Jesus also happens to us when we are baptized. The same powerful events which people witnessed at the time of Jesus' baptism still occur for us, but in a hidden way, because Jesus is raised from the dead, and he works spiritually within each person. That's because of faith. Faith is believing in things not seen. People saw these things in the baptism of Jesus. We see them through the eyes of faith, happening even to us and our children and our grandchildren who come forward for baptism. So for instance, when people were being baptized by John, we're told they were confessing their sins. Same thing happens even when a child is baptized. There's no verbal confession, but baptism washes away the stain of original sin. And for adults who are baptized, there is immediate forgiveness for all sins. That is something that happens within a person who is reborn to innocence. When Jesus was baptized, the heavens were opened. This is a symbolic way of suggesting that heaven and earth are united. God can act upon us directly. So in fact, when we were baptized and when your children or grandchildren were baptized, the heavens were opened, so to speak. God's grace poured directly into the heart of the person being baptized. This was done again in a visible way for Jesus when the Holy Spirit descended upon him, but it happens for us in a hidden way. The forgiveness of sin, the beginning of this transformation into the life of Jesus within us. That's the same Holy Spirit who unites us to the church and to each other as brothers and sisters in Christ. And what about that voice that was heard from the heavens at Jesus' baptism? Well, I don't know if anybody who's heard God speaking to them directly at their own baptism. But God does speak when we are baptized. He says, "This is my beloved son. This is now my beloved daughter, in whom I am well pleased." We become God's children at the moment of our baptism. So, all of this is a way of saying that baptism is an outward sign of what is going on within a person. That's how the church mediates the ongoing ministry of Christ. It ritualizes his words and actions so they can then occur within our hearts and souls and minds. And through that ritual, the sacrament, Christ is present to us in a real way, although he is hidden from our sight. That's why the sacraments really are matters of faith. We believe in the things we cannot see. Powerful realities are happening, but we can't see them. But we still believe. We know it happened for Jesus, and we believe it happened for us. Then I guess the most important part of baptism comes when everything is said and done. Think of all that happened to Jesus right after his baptism. He's forced into the desert by the Spirit. He's tempted by the devil. So once we are baptized, isn't it true that we have to enter the real world? We will know what sin is. We will know what it means to be tempted. But we are still baptized. We are God's beloved children. And just as Jesus began his work of battling against sin and death, so by our baptism we are incorporated into that struggle. We will fight temptation to the best of our ability. We may not always succeed, but we are still baptized. We are unique. We have power within us. Our family and friends may have come to celebrate a nice ritual, but what happens after that is very critical. We continue to grow and mature after our baptism. First as children growing up, then into our difficult adolescence, and then into our adult lives. All along the way, the grace of baptism is at work within us. And that grace of that baptism opens up the door to our first confession when we can freely acknowledge our sins. That baptism opens the door to receiving the body and blood of Christ in the Eucharist. That baptism prepares young people who are coming of age for confirmation. That baptism opens the door to marriage in the faith community, or in my case, ordination to priesthood. And for each of us, baptism will always be at work, even at the most critical moment of life, when we are sick or when we are preparing to leave this world. We can receive the sacrament of anointing of the sick. Why? Because we are baptized. We can call upon God, who is our Father, and he will hear us. So on the feast of the baptism of the Lord, it's good for us to reflect on the power of our own baptism. Do you know when you were baptized and in what church you were baptized in? Who did your baptism? Which priest? And who were your godparents? Those are all important factors in your identity today. How has your baptism blessed you throughout the years? How has it assisted you in living the gospel every day? How has it guided your thoughts and words so that you may be witness to who you are, a son of God, a daughter of God? Today we rejoice in the gift God has given to us as baptism. Now comes the work, walking with Christ all of our days, to the cross and to the resurrection.